Hello, everyone, and welcome to Marian Moments, our Church Militant program that we are producing during the Wuhan virus to help you keep your thoughts concentrated on the supernatural in addition to all of the natural stuff going on with the virus and government response and the shutdowns, the lockdowns, and the politics and the unemployment, all of it. All very important, of course, but not as important as the supernatural. So we just take a little half hour or so out of each day, each work day here, weekday to just sort of stress to hold up right in front of you again the importance of the supernatural over the natural, although obviously both are important. Now, the theme that we are picking up from again with yesterday and probably carry through for most of the week is this topic of biblical criticism, historical biblical criticism. I want to bring up a graphic we had yesterday as we get into it and just show you. Sorry, am I out of order, guys? I'm out of order. Right? I forgot. The book. My goodness, I went straight to. See, that's what happens when I don't wear my glasses. I missed the first cue in my notes here. The show is modeled after this book, Mary Day by Day. I heard panic in the control room. That's how I knew I'd screwed up. It has within it all 365 days of the year, a little scripture passage, a little reflection by a saint on that passage, and then a prayer. So we'll go straight to that and begin our prayers today. When this is from John chapter 19, when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs, but one soldier opened his side with a lance, and immediately blood and water poured out. A reflection from St. Bernard. It is your heart, O Mary, that is pierced with the steel of the lance, much more so than the heart of your son, who has already breathed his last. Yeah, thinking about that for a moment before we get to the prayer, I mean, consider that you're the mother, and you see your son, he's dead, and now he has this further humiliation of his remains with a lance being driven into it. Granted, he doesn't feel that particular pain, but you as the mother certainly would. The whole thing would have been just completely horrifying for any mother, but for this mother, mother of purity, who knew who her son was, and was completely innocent, both herself and her son, obviously, to sit there, stand there at the foot of the cross and behold all of this, and even the indignation post-mortem of having to endure that. Just, yes, takes you right back to the prophecy from Simeon, a sword thine own soul shall pierce, indeed. So our prayer, O Mary, let me grieve with you over the saving death of your beloved Son. Holy Mother, pierce me through. In my heart, each wound renew of my Savior crucified. Amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Everything in Catholic teaching is wedded together like the different lines of thread or whatever they use to put together a shirt, for example, or a jacket. Everything supports every other thing. And if you pull out one thing, then, if you remember, your mom used to say, don't pull a loose thread because then the sleeve will fall off and you have to throw the shirt away. It was just cut it and get back to business. Well, it's the same thing with garments of any sort. If you start to pull on a loose thread or you find a little, cottony something, you pull it, the whole thing starts to fall apart because the garment itself is one integral whole. Well, such is the case with church teaching as well. Every single point of church teaching is directly connected to another point of church teaching, specifically how the scriptures reveal to us who Our Lady is, who Mary, the virgin espoused, betrothed to Joseph in Nazareth, mother of the Redeemer. Well, she brings forth the Redeemer. So John the Baptist is his cousin. It's just one thing that it's all related to each other. So there was this movement in the late 19th century, and certainly continuing now, unfortunately, a modernist movement that used as one of its tools. It said, well, let's see if we can undermine Scripture, then we can get at everything else. Again, that's kind of the loose thread. So let's go after Scripture. So now you can put the graphic up, guys. Sorry, I jumped the gun there. Biblical criticism is what we had up yesterday, but just as a reminder for those of you who were here, and obviously for those of you who weren't, this is what we're talking about this week. Biblical criticism is this school, I suppose you could call it that, or a discipline of looking at Scripture and sort of deciphering it. What does this mean? What does that mean? But here are sort of the three major components of biblical criticism, that it precludes the sacred nature of the texts. So right out of the box, it denies inspiration in the sense that the Catholic Church understands inspiration. It denies that there is inspiration by the Holy Spirit, that there is a deeper spiritual meaning. It's looking at them essentially, as we go down to the second bullet point there, it studies the text, in other words, the words that were written, the composition, and the history of the time. It studies this like you would study Shakespeare. You know, there's no inspiration, there's no divine anything in it. There might be a good moral message here or there, but that's the end of it. And then the last point is it claims to lay the groundwork for meaningful interpretation of Scripture. Well, it may claim that, but as we're going to demonstrate here, it is far from doing that. Now, this idea of looking at the words, again, you begin, your beginning point is there is nothing in here divine. This is a history. And maybe there's some psalms that are songs and some other things, but it's history. It's history, or it's collections of Jewish sayings like, Ecclesiastes and things like that. But there's nothing particularly divine. It might inspire a person here or a person there to do something good, but that's the extent of it. That's the beginning point. So because of that, when historical biblical critics study the Scripture, they go into the Scripture and they say, this can't be the case. It can't be the case that our Lord, that Jesus walked across the water, because that would be miraculous and miracles don't really happen. So what is really being said here? So they completely discount the face of it and go straight in to try to figure out some crazy other, interpretation of what's going on. Now, we have a few of them here, a few famous examples that are up. First, I want to talk about this. I don't think there's a Catholic around, if you've been to Mass in the last 800 years, who hasn't heard the ridiculous claim that the multiplication of the loaves, the miracle of the multiplication of the loaves, was in fact not actually a miracle. The miracle was not that the loaves are multiplied and, the fish and all of that until basketfuls were left over. That the claim by the historical biblical critics is that the miracle was that everybody reached into their pocket and shared their fish and their bread with each other. That's the claim. Because you have this situation, here is a historical account. You can back me for a second, guys. There's this historical account where, here's Jesus, there's a few thousand people he's preaching to. They're kind of out in the middle of nowhere. And the apostles come and say, hey, we should send them to go find some local towns or something to eat. Everybody's getting hungry. And so the historical critic says, so that means, let's see, there is the account here of a miracle of the loaves, but since Jesus isn't divine, that couldn't happen. So they didn't go anywhere to get the food because Jesus tells them to sit down. So if you're a historical critic, you would say, well, that means they already had the food with them. So, what you get from that, first of all, it's stupid on the face of it. Because what you have to posit then is that you've got 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 people walking around with dead fish in their pockets. And at some point, they just reached in and started eating fish and then handing them off to somebody else. And that's the supposed miracle. If you're out in the middle of the desert walking around with dead fish in your pocket, it's kind of, I'm presuming they were dead. Maybe the historical critic would posit that they were alive. Anyway, that is one of the famous examples, and you hear it all the time. I was actually at Mass here in the Archdiocese of Detroit in a well-known church, Shrine of the Little Flower. And they said, the priest stood up, on the Feast of Corpus Christi, don't ask me why I was there, on the Feast of Corpus Christi, and said in his homily, this is not the time to discuss whether the miracle of the loaves was real or was the miracle really they just shared the bread with each other. Yes, it is, Father. This is exactly the time to discuss that. So again, see, there's this perversion of the mind and the doctrine and everything else being spread out there, by undermining what the Scripture is actually saying. We have another example here. I'm going to go through a few of these so you can sort of see exactly how the critics, the historical biblical critics, come at things. They say that there are contradictions in the accounts of the Beatitudes between Matthew's account and Luke's account of the Beatitudes. Matthew lists 8. Luke lists 4. So the biblical critic says, aha, there were really only 4 originally, but then some point after that, some other community came along and added 4 more. So that's not really, so that would tell us that Luke's gospel is probably older than Matthew's gospel, and now we're figuring everything out. That's the way their brains think, honestly. This is the way they think about this stuff. No, it's probably a safe bet as you go through and you read the Gospels. I want to concentrate largely on the Gospels because as Catholics, we're mostly familiar with the account of our Blessed Lord by the four evangelists. They go through the Gospels and they'll say, oh, this isn't real, that can't be real. Oh, here's one. Oh, if he did this, and we know that can't be a miracle, so it must be that. It is, as you read through, you know, it's probably very much the case that since our Lord traveled around the entire region for 3 years, that quite often, he would repeat things. He would repeat parables. He would pretty much just say the parable one time and then never say it again when, he went to the next town. Of course, I mean, he had a litany or a host of these various parables and stories and accounts and, teachings, and, whether he said them exactly the same each way or whether he, what was recorded by a particular evangelist may have only been interested in telling you about these four. The fact that Luke says four and Matthew says eight doesn't mean that there were just originally four and Matthew lied or made up four more. It just means that they're different accounts of the same thing. Luke isn't interested in telling you all eight. Matthew was. That's all. Did Jesus sometimes go to different places and emphasize four of the Beatitudes because he knew, because he's God, that his audience needed to hear those four, so those are the four he concentrated on, but he goes to the next town and says the original eight. It's pathetic. It's intellectually pathetic and dishonest to try to read into a book which says, here we are, we're the Bible, this is divinely inspired, blah, 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 and then to discount its major claim and then examine it some other way. It's completely intellectually dishonest. Another one of our situations here, famous example, is the destruction of Jerusalem prophecies by our Lord. Now remember, they say he's not God. It's no divine. There's nothing here divine in the book. Might be, a good moral teaching here or there, pet your dog and you don't kick the cat and stuff like that. But everything else is, to be discounted. All right. Our Lord says, makes it very clear, certainly in Matthew's gospel, about the upcoming destruction of Jerusalem. When he's carrying his cross, he says, I believe it's Luke's gospel, can't remember exactly, but whichever gospel, he says to the women of Jerusalem, daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, weep for yourselves and for your children. And then he goes on to say, for a time is coming when men will say, to the mountains fall on us and the hills cover us. And all of this, he's prophesying as he's carrying his cross to these women who, out of good heart and love and, adulation and adoration of him, want to, are upset at what they're seeing. And he says, hold your tears for yourselves and for your children. And there's a prophecy about the destruction of Jerusalem. The biblical critics say, well, he's not God, so he couldn't have known about that. So that means that gospel and that account was written after the destruction of Jerusalem has already happened, and then they're writing it and they stick those words in Jesus' mouth as though he had made a prophecy. So that's how they begin to erroneously date the gospels. They look at them and say, not a miracle, but he's talking about a miracle that we know did happen. Jerusalem was destroyed by Titus and his 10th legion between 67 and 70 AD. But he couldn't have known that in advance back around the year 33, 34. So that means that this gospel was written after that. And then to sort of prove by lying that Jesus was God, they attributed that prophecy to him back there. But we know that's not true. That's their approach. That's how they go to it. One more example. Touching directly on our Blessed Mother. We mentioned this yesterday. Since there are no other that we know of, have been discovered, records of either an empire-wide census or regional censuses that were going on all over various regions of the Roman Empire. There's no other historical records for a big worldwide thing. They say, the opening account of in Luke's Gospel of the Nativity narrative, in those days, Caesar Augustus sent out a decree that the whole world should be enrolled and everybody had to go back to their hometown. Well, there was no census, so this is just a fabrication of Luke to figure out a way to put Jesus and the Blessed Mother and Saint Joseph in Bethlehem, because the Old Testament prophecies say he was born in Bethlehem, but he's not in Bethlehem, he's from Nazareth. So, Luke must have sat down and figured out, how can I get them into Nazareth, Bethlehem at the time Jesus was born? Aha, I'll make up a story about a census, and they had to do it because of the Roman Empire. See, this is what historical criticism does. Now, what I want to do, this is all very fine and academic discussion and stuff, but what's the point? Well, I want to take you sort of through the flow of what historical criticism does, biblical criticism does. First of all, it's built on these, I'm building up to the main point, bullet point by bullet point here. The scriptures, its claim is the scriptures are solely works of men in specific times and places in history, so that's how we have to understand them, nothing else. It's just like reading Shakespeare, it's just like reading Cicero, it's just like reading Aristotle, it's just recording various things that happened at those particular times and places. Next bullet point. So therefore, the claim of Jesus's divinity, claims of Jesus's divinity are untrue. That's the major point of this. It's not the ultimate point, but it makes the Catholic Church then wrong foundationally. If Jesus is not divine, then the church is wrong foundationally. If the church is wrong foundationally, then it has no authority. And if it has no authority, therefore, it can be ignored in what it claims and teaches. And that is the point of biblical historical criticism. It is to arrive at that point. It begins by tearing the thread out of your garment of sacred scripture. Now, this was all happening, as we said, around the end of the 19th century, it started sort of getting a little head of steam in Lutheran universities in Germany in the 1860s and 1870s, and eventually spilled over into some Catholic houses of formation. Not a shock. A Jesuit in Ireland was the first one who kind of led the charge of this in the very late 1890s and into the early 1900s. But he was, but I have to say, at the time, the Jesuits kicked him out of the order. So at the time, there were actually more good Jesuits than there were bad Jesuits. We, of course, know that has flipped dramatically. But the Pope who really tackled this, Pope Leo XIII went after modernism. This was part of modernism. It's one of the stools, legs of modernism. Pope Leo XIII went after it a lot, but it was really Saint Pope Pius X who responded to this. And he wrote an encyclical called Pascende Dominici Grigis in 1907, which is translated into Feeding the Lord's Flock. And it was an exhortation, to the world's bishops to say, you need to recognize what's going on here with your flock. Your flock is being taken away from you, snatched away from you because of this air of modernism, a heresy that he called the synthesis of all heresies, because he recognized that little flow that we went through originally to attack the church's authority and render the church meaningless and its teachings incorrect or founded on nothing except just sort of the whims of man completely destroys Christianity. And he understood that. So this is why he wrote this encyclical. And I'd like to show you three different points. It's a somewhat longer, although I would recommend if you have an opportunity, you're sitting at home, I'd recommend you to read the encyclical. But paragraph or point 34, this is one of them. I'm going to show you three from this particular one because paragraph 34 is about scripture. He says, the result of this dismembering of the sacred books and this partition of them throughout the centuries is naturally that the scriptures can no longer be attributed to the authors whose names they bear. And come back to me for a second, guys. So what you will see with the historical critics is the claim that Saint John did not write the gospel of Saint John, but a bunch of people who kind of liked, who he was and sort of followed him, and they kind of hung around and they sort of wrote this thing, and Joe over here threw in his bit and Jane over there threw in her bit, and they kind of mixed it up a little bit, and that's just kind of, everybody's all done it. Well, we're all followers of John, so let's just say it's his gospel. That's what they say, and that's exactly what Pope St. Pius X is getting at there. The reason it is important that both Matthew and John, it is their gospels, is because they were the eyewitnesses to the accounts they're talking about. They were there. John, at the end of his gospel, says, it is an eyewitness telling you these things so that you may believe. And there's a whole lot of other things that Jesus said and did that we haven't written down because they'd fill all the books in the world. So the historical biblical critic simply dismisses all of that. And to dismiss John's gospel as being authored by John particularly touches on our Blessed Mother, because his gospel, unlike Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which are called the synoptic gospels, which is Greek for essentially seen with one eye, there's a lot of similarities between them. His gospel stands out as being sort of theologically more advanced or superior. That's why John is always pictured, his animal is pictured with him as an eagle, because he soars, climbs the heights of heaven. Why would his gospel be so much more? Well, because the Mother of God lived in his house for all those years and would have provided many of those insights to him. And John is standing at the foot of the cross. So unlike Matthew and Mark and Luke weren't around yet, at least not certainly not as apostles and not evangelists at the time, it is John and his relationship with our Blessed Mother which provides those penetrating insights. Our Lady knew that Jesus was specifically the Word, the Logos, the eternal Logos. She knew that, and she imparts that to John, and that's why his gospel begins, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." John already knew that, of course, himself, but Our Lady is sort of giving, putting the mortar into the in between the bricks of this gospel. So to deny the authorship of being John, but just a bunch of John's friends who are just sort of hanging around one night, having a bunch of beer and writing down notes and jamming it all together, is a great insult to the authenticity of the Gospels themselves. But again, the point is you have to undermine the Scriptures, and let's start with the Gospels, undermine them. And once you've undermined that, you've destroyed everything else. That's the point. The second point from section 34, the biblical criticism scholars seem, in fact, to have constructed for themselves certain types of narration and discourses upon which they base their decision as to whether a thing, a biblical narrative or a story, is out of place or not. Yeah, he's going straight at them here, saying you guys are completely disingenuous. You approach this with a prejudiced, a predetermined look at sacred scripture, and then you will not deviate from that. You know, it's kind of like CNN. Don't let the facts get in the way of your story. Just say whatever it is, and that's it. Biblical criticism is fake scripture study. Absolutely. And one more from paragraph 34, section 34. To hear them talk about their works on the sacred books, in which they have been able to discover so much that is defective, one would imagine that before them, nobody ever even glanced through the pages of Scripture. You can hear the sarcasm dripping from his pen with this. Whereas the truth is that a whole multitude of doctors, infinitely superior to them in genius, in erudition, in sanctity, have sifted the sacred books in every way, and so far from finding imperfections in them, have thanked God more and more the deeper they have gone into them. I highly, highly, highly recommend, folks, that you, if you get a chance, and, you know, presuming people are sitting at home and, you know, maybe twiddling their thumbs more than they would otherwise be, get a hold of that encyclical. It's right there on the Vatican's website. It's all over the internet. There's 100 different pages that have you. You can click on anything and read it. Read that. It will give you a great overview of the problems in the church today, because this modernism of which ripping the Bible apart is one attack prong that has completely destroyed so many people's faith and so damaged and weakened the church. To that last point, I want to show you here this. I had this out here last week, this stack of, they're really sort of scholarly Bibles. I think this is, here it is. It's called the Navarre Bible Series, and each book is essentially one of the books of the New Testament. There's a couple that are down here, you know, like the Catholic Letters, or is it this one? The Catholic Letters, whether two or three of them are combined. But what each of these books does, specifically about what Pope Saint Pius X had said there, is that it's a collection. This particular Bible series is a collection of many of the thoughts, reflections, histories, and everything else brought in by the doctors of the church, the fathers of the church, looking at these various things. As he said, more erudite, more genius. Doesn't take much of a genius, I have to say. If the bar is the historical critics, that's a kind of low bar for genius. But nonetheless, their erudition, their sanctity, these people, these men lived the faith. They went through the faith like nobody's business. to make sure that every single thing, there wasn't a syllable, you know, unturned, examined and everything else, not just for its own sake, but in relation to all the other fabrics, the other threads in the garment. It's very, very, as you read their reflections on this. I mean, St. Augustine has a reflection on the Psalms, his commentary on the Psalms that is incredibly moving. There's commentaries of, you know, by St. Thomas Aquinas and just on and on about it. I mean, there is not a syllable in Scripture that has not been thoroughly gone over for thousands of years, 2,000 years. I mean, if really on one level, if you wanted to see sort of a more contemporary version of that, read The Life of Christ by Bishop Sheen. It is a hallmark. I've read that book probably, 10 or 15 times, and then gone back to it a few times here and there in different parts and chapters, because it is this. It's a reflection. It goes into what did this mean and at the time. And, you know, another thing that's also interesting is that as you go through sort of the ripping apart of Scripture by these, it's probably children listening, so I'll just say not charitable men, and leave it at that. As you go through their examinations of sacred Scripture, it's really so prideful and so hubris, such a hubris, to say that here in the 19th century, which is when they started doing this, and into the 20th century, that they could somehow discern the actual meaning of Scripture when the very people who wrote it were eyewitnesses to some of the events going on, and their followers, everything was passed down through this oral tradition that eventually was written down in various times and places, who their followers knew what was being talked about and wrote it down in their own biblical commentaries, which were then passed on, to all of a sudden have this sort of, you know, wonderful flow throughout all of history, and then have this interruption of it, this explosion of it 19 centuries later, and say, nope, everything that happened there is all wrong, and, you know, that's just, they're nice, pious guys, but, you know, it's all really a bunch of cock and bull, nothing really true about it. Here we know that people just walked around and grabbed fish out of their pocket and shared it with each other. The hubris is monumental. So anyway, you might be saying, what's all have to do with the Blessed Mother and everything else? All of this has to do, every single thread in the church's teachings, in the garment, the beautiful garment of the church, are all interconnected, and you cannot. Remember, if the church isn't real, then it's not modeled after, or it has no authority and it's just some made-up institution, then it's not modeled after the kingdom of heaven. Of course, we don't know anything that even exists either, because that's in the Bible, which is probably just some made-up thing also. That means that Our Lady is not queen of heaven because her son isn't the king, because her son's just some crazy preacher running around saying stuff and telling people to eat fish out of each other's pockets, and that makes her not the queen. So, every single point of Catholic teaching is interconnected with every other single point. That's why every single syllable of Catholic teaching must be defended to the death if necessary, because it all comes from God. It is all divine revelation, and we don't get to tinker with it. Anyway, we normally do questions and things right now, but at this point, just we're getting a little bit later. This took a little bit longer, but I thought we'll go straight to a little graphic we have here to remind you of this, that St. Jerome, as he was translating the sacred scriptures from Greek into Latin, said, ignorance of the scriptures is ignorance of Christ. All the scriptures point to Christ. He is the center point of human history. Likewise, he's the center point of all the scriptures, as the scriptures themselves say, in Luke's gospel, when he was meeting with first Easter Sunday, when he was meeting the disciples, encountered them on the road to Emmaus, he said, he opened up the scriptures and revealed to them how they all pointed to him. And that would have been the Old Testament at the time. So we have a wonderful presentation we made a number of years ago called Where Did the Bible Come From? It's on our premium site. It's three parts. Each part's roughly 40 minutes or so long. It's a very, 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 very good comprehensive overview of where did we actually get the Bible, and understanding the significant role that the church played in it. And since it was the church that put together the canon of sacred scripture to, on its own authority, to attack the sacred scripture itself, as the biblical critics do, is really a roundabout way of coming back around attacking the teaching authority of the church and saying it doesn't have any. So we will wrap up right now, please, and go straight to the St. Michael prayer, running a little late, so I want to do this. We wrap up each show with this. This is the prayer to St. Michael in Latin. We say it in English, then we say it in Latin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle, be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray, and do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Sancta Michael Archangele, defende nos in praelio, contra iniquitiam et insidias diaboli esto presidium. If you're sitting at home, try to say this in Latin with us. Impedit illi Deus, supplicesse precamor, tuque, princeps miletiae celestis, santanam oleosque spiritus malignos, quiad perditionem animatum pervagantur in mundo, divina virtute in infernum detrude. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll get to questions tomorrow. I just didn't want to, I wanted to make all of these points because I think they're very important given the condition of so many problems, the condition of the church today, so many problems and evils in it. You need to understand where this came from and how you can combat it. Get yourself to a computer, look up Pascendi, Dominici Grigis, read what St. Pope Pius X had to say about the errors of modernism and understand how the undermining of the scripture was a very key component of that and has produced the horrible fruit we have around us today. That's it for today. We'll see you tomorrow right here at 1 p.m. Please remember to join us at 4:45 p.m. Eastern Time for evening prayer for Vespers. If you're in our time zone, that'd be wonderful. If you're not, well, still pray with us. That's fine. That's it for today. God love you. Thank you.